of a good construction ordinance is to minimize the amount of eroded sediments and other pollutants that can be carried from sites in stormwater runoff. Meeting this goal requires using a range of best management practices, or BMPs, with specifics depending on individual site conditions. Details must be included in a site's Stormwater Pollution Prevention Plan, or SWIP, and should be reviewed prior to initial site inspections. This training discusses erosion and sediment control BMPs inspectors are most likely to see, along with some problems that can occur when installation is poor and maintenance is lacking. Traffic leaving construction sites during periods of wet weather can drag large amounts of mud onto nearby roads, potentially endangering public safety. To address this, rock construction entrances must be installed at all points where vehicles need routine access. Stone at least 2 inches in diameter should be placed over geotextile fabric to a minimum thickness of 6 inches. Fabric can help reduce stone lost into the ground under the weight of constant traffic. Construction entrances must also be installed for individual building lots. These are typically located where driveways eventually will be built. Good construction entrances will go a long way toward minimizing complaints about muddy streets. A variety of BMPs exist to control eroded sediments in perimeter areas, and silt fence is the most popular choice. Silt fence is intended to intercept sheet flow runoff and cause it to pond. It can be highly effective when located in relatively flat areas and is installed following elevation contours. It must be trenched 6 inches into the ground, pulled taut, and then backfilled. Silt fence can be easily overwhelmed if improperly located or installed. 100 linear feet of silt fence can handle sheet flow runoff from, at most, half an acre of gently sloping ground. It is not intended for use in areas of concentrated flow. Lack of maintenance of silt fence is a common problem observed in the field. Sometimes removing accumulated sediments is enough to keep the control functional. Once silt fence fabric has been torn or support stakes broken, the only option is to reinstall. Other options for perimeter sediment controls exist, such as straw or compost-filled socks. These can be especially useful around individual lots where access is an issue. Unlike silt fence, filter socks can withstand limited vehicular traffic and remain effective. Better sediment controls installed early on may be more expensive, but usually reduce maintenance needs and other headaches over the course of the project. Storm sewer inlets must be protected to minimize the amount of sediment that enters the storm sewer system. Each site SWIP should identify the inlets that require protection. A variety of approaches exist, all of which are designed to pond water directly in front of the catch basin itself or around the inlet protection structure. Deposited sediments must be removed periodically to ensure the practice will function as designed. The drainage area leading to a single inlet protection device should not exceed 1 acre. Be aware that ponding water in roads can create hazardous driving conditions, especially during winter months. If storm sewers drain to appropriately sized sediment basins on the property, it may be wise to forego inlet protection and stress individual lot controls instead. Sediment that does get on roads will be captured by downstream basins. Inlet protection maintenance often requires replacing the materials used. Removal of built-up sediments can extend the life of the device employed, but if rips or tears to fabric occur, the only option is replacement. Sediment traps and sediment basins are the most effective ways to minimize soil loss from construction projects. These controls are needed on most sites because drainage areas are generally too big for silt fence and other perimeter controls to be effective on their own. When possible, basins and traps must be installed before upslope earth-moving activities can begin. Until storm sewers are installed, channels, shallow berms, or other temporary structures can be used to direct runoff into basins or traps where eroded sediments will be captured. Sediment traps are temporary ponds with simple outlet structures. Traps are most often located at the end of drainage swales and in perimeter areas. A typical outlet consists of a dam made of heavy rock that is overlain with number 57 stone. Lengths, widths, and depths of all sediment traps must be specified in the site's plan. Sediment basins may also be temporary site features, but more frequently are transformed into permanent retention or detention ponds. While construction is active, sediment basins perform double duty by capturing eroded sediments in addition to storing excess runoff. Basins should be designed with maximized distances between inlets and outlets. When site conditions limit this distance, structures known as baffles can be added. Baffles lengthen flow path distances, which will increase the time runoff spends in the basin, ultimately reducing amounts of sediment discharged from the site. Basin outlets must also be modified to ensure maximum pollutant removal occurs during site construction. The most common methods involve the use of skimmers and temporary riser pipes. Temporary risers are L-shaped pipes that attach to the basin outlet in a watertight manner. The number and size of openings on the vertical part of the pipe are generally basin-specific. This information should be contained in the stormwater pollution prevention plan. Failure to modify outlets correctly is a common problem. The faircloth skimmer is the preferred dewatering device for sediment basins. The skimmer should be attached to a stub on the outlet structure with a watertight flexible coupling. The skimmer should also be anchored to the shore so that it stays in its correct position. For traps and basins to remain effective, sediment must be removed when storage areas are full. Maintenance can be minimized if adjacent bare ground, including basin embankments, is stabilized as soon as possible. Temporary stabilization is one of the least expensive and most effective erosion control practices. It is accomplished by seeding bare soils with rapidly growing grasses or small grains, such as rye. During colder months or dry spells when seed won't germinate, simply covering bare ground with straw, wood chips, or other woody debris can significantly reduce erosion. Temporary stabilization is required whenever a bare area is expected to remain idle for 21 days or longer. Measures must be put in place within 7 days of the last disturbance. If bare areas lie within 50 feet of a stream, wetland, or other water feature, efforts to stabilize soil must be initiated within 2 days. Permanent stabilization establishes a dense covering of vegetation over disturbed areas that have reached final grade. This involves applying a permanent seed mix to soils that have been adequately prepared to support strong growth. Vegetation densities exceeding 70% must be established for areas to be considered permanently stabilized. Sometimes trenches that have been excavated for utilities or building footers fill with water. Before construction can proceed, this unwanted water, which can be muddy, has to be pumped from the excavation. Pumping from the top of an excavation helps reduce the amount of mud in the water. Directing flow to a sediment basin or trap is ideal. If this is not possible, portable dewatering bags can be used to accomplish the same goal. While SWIPs emphasize erosion and sediment control, site plans must also address other potential sources of water pollution that are present at most construction sites. Roll-off boxes or dumpsters with lids are the best way to manage construction debris, especially waste packaging materials and lunch trash. Wind-blown trash is often a source of complaints from angry neighbors. Concrete washout is a commonly mismanaged waste that is easily addressed. Signs should be posted designating areas where concrete trucks can wash out. The designated area must be large enough to accommodate all the trucks expected to use it. Site inspections should note when designated areas have reached capacity and need to be either re-established or moved elsewhere on the property. Waste paints, stains, plaster, and other materials must also be managed appropriately at construction sites. Waste fluids of any kind are never to be disposed on the ground. The same rule applies to fuels and other fluids used in excavating equipment. These materials should be stored inside structures capable of containing spills or leaks or within enclosed trailers. Spill kits should be on hand for cleanups. Any spill which reaches a stream or other waterway should be reported to Ohio EPA's spill hotline at 800 282-9378. Regardless of how big a construction project is, the goal of stormwater management is always the same. Keep eroded sediments on site and manage all construction-related materials so that exposure to precipitation is minimized. We hope the basics covered here will be helpful to those who will be conducting site inspections. For more detailed information, the Ohio Department of Natural Resources Rainwater and Land Development Manual is an important resource. Additional information is also available through Ohio EPA's Office of Compliance Assistance and Pollution Prevention.